last week at the final moments of Jesus on the cross. But rarely do we ever hear anything about what happened after the cross. When Jesus had finished crying out, last week we looked at the final four cries on the cross, and we believe that right before Jesus died, he said, "It is finished." I talked about what that meant, that he had finished the work of God on the cross, and now he could rest. And now he could bow his head and give up his spirit. But we don't think about what happens immediately after that. And this morning, I want us to see what the effects were when Jesus cried out and breathed his last breath. There are five things that I want to show you this morning. So if you're taking notes and you have the notes in front of you, there's a place for you to talk up, for you to list all the five effects and what the meaning was for there. If you don't have enough space there, you can turn the sheet over and take your own notes. And then in front of you, if you came in this morning, you could have the parallel passages of these particular events. And then there's a series of cross-references that I'm going to walk us through to show us some implications of what happened. This is interesting. These things that happen afterwards don't happen in the Gospel of John. John doesn't declare them at all. It's only the synoptic Gospels. But I'm going to be using Matthew as my major source, and then we'll look at the other ones to go with it. So let's look at what happened right after Jesus cried, "It is finished. Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." So even after Jesus' death, there's something that's still going to happen. I think this stuff is great. So let's look in Matthew chapter 27, verse 51. It says, "And behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split." We basically see the same thing in Mark and Luke. They tell us the same thing. I'm going to go back and connect "the earth shook and the rocks were split" in a minute. That's why I didn't highlight that in purple. I want to focus just on what happened first. So I want us to see, first of all, the effect on the curtain. What happens to the curtain? All right? Now this is really interesting. The only thing that was affected in the temple was the curtain. The temple wasn't affected itself. Now you say, well, how in the world? First of all, we would say, well, the earthquake caused that to happen. But if you look at the order of events in Matthew, Matthew is very clear to give you the temple, the curtain tearing first, and then the earthquake. They're not simultaneous. Which means whatever tore the veil was not the earthquake, it was the very hand of God. Okay. Anybody want to go wow to that for a minute? How can you not wow that one? Somehow, and you think, well, how in the world could God do that without the earthquake? Oh, we're talking about the same God that opened his mouth at the beginning of creation, spoke light into existence at 186,000 miles per second. And you say, can God tear a temple, a curtain? Yeah, I think so. Because if you don't believe that, then you have a very low view of God. But if you believe that's nothing for God to do what he did apart from the earthquake, he tears the temple. Now watch this. What's significant about it? He tears the temple or the curtain without touching the temple from top to bottom. Big deal. Big deal. You get that? Big deal. Notice it wasn't torn from bottom to top. What does that mean? What does that symbolize? The idea that it was torn from the top to the bottom, it was God opening up a way and giving us now access back to him. What had just happened on the cross? Jesus had just finished the work. He cried out, you know, "Father, I've done your will. It is finished." And the moment that happened, immediate, God said, okay, Jesus' sacrifice was accepted by me. I'm going to open up the temple. I'm going to rip down the curtain, which was what kept them from God. What was the significance of the temple? If you look in Leviticus 16, verses 2 and 15 on your cross references, So the Lord said to Moses, tell your brother Aaron that he shall not enter any time into the holy place inside the veil before the mercy seat which is on the ark, or he will die, for I will appear in the cloud over the mercy seat. Then later on, they're told to enter, slaughter the goat with the sin offering, which is for the people, and bring the blood inside the veil and do with its blood as he did with the blood of the bull, sprinkle it on the mercy seat and in front of the mercy seat. Big deal, unless you understand the Old Testament. Right? There was a place called the Holy Place, and then there was the Holy of Holies. The priests were allowed to come in and minister before God on behalf of the people, and they came in, but they never went behind that second veil except for one day a year called the Day of Atonement. And they went in on that day, prescribed by the Lord, doing what they were supposed to do, to sprinkle blood on the mercy seat for the sins of not only the priest, but the sins of the people. It's a big deal. What's the mercy seat? The mercy seat was what sat on, was the top of the Ark of the Covenant. And it's what separated God's holy presence from their sin. Because inside the Ark of the Covenant was the broken tablets. That was one of the things. There were three things in there. Aaron's rod, a jar of manna, and the broken tablets. And what that represented when they sprinkled blood on the mercy seat, it represented the fact that the blood covered and made possible for them to have access to God even one day a year to approach him and to ask for forgiveness. Now what happened on the cross? I think the cross was the mercy seat. The New Testament mercy seat. It was where the blood was poured out and what gave... When Jesus died, God said, okay, he's opened the way for you to come back. Now watch this. In Hebrews 9, 6 and 7, we see, now when these things have been so prepared, the priest continually entered the outer tabernacle performing the divine worship. But into the second, only the high priest enters once a year, not without taking blood, which he offers for himself for the sins of the people. So we see what goes on. But look at this. In Hebrews 9, 11 and 12, it says, but when Christ appeared as high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of his creation, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood, he entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. Now watch this. The earthly tabernacle, if you know anything about the Old Testament, was made as a pattern or a picture of the perfect tabernacle in heaven. So when it says he entered not through the earthly tabernacle, but he entered through the perfect tabernacle, which means after Jesus was going to sacrifice himself, Christ was going to raise him from the dead, he was going to be seated at the right hand of the Father, he went back to the Holy of Holies in heaven as the perfect sacrifice on our behalf and made a way for us to get back to God. Because up until that point, man had had a broken relationship with God. And the only way that we could enter back into a right relationship was through the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Oh! That excites me. I don't know what it does for you, but it excites me because I think about what I was like before I was saved. I had a broken relationship with God. I folded my hands to God and said, I will not be your slave. I will not be anybody's slave. And the moment Christ got a hold of me and his atoning sacrifice paid for my sins, God opened a way back to a relationship with him, which gives me freedom, which gives me the life that Christ always had wanted me to live. And now I can live it with freedom and the right relationship with him. Oh, I just love it. Look at John 14, 6. I'm going to share this in a couple minutes, but I just want to highlight it. John 14, 6 said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father through me. Jesus opened up the way. That's the way he's talking about in John 14. And watch this. This is what happens. Look, therefore, having been justified by faith in Romans 5, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, because Romans 5 later on tells us that we're enemies with God. We're under God's wrath. We're his enemies. You know what? You're going to take care of your enemies. But we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained our introduction by faith into the grace in which we stand, and we exult in the hope of the glory of God. And because, Romans 8:1, because Jesus opened up the veil, God opened up the veil, opening up access back to God through the blood of Christ, through the death of Christ, there's now no condemnation for those who are in relationship with Jesus Christ. Hallelujah! Because of what Christ did for me, because of me placing faith and trust in his death for me, I can walk around knowing that I'm no longer condemned by God. Do you get an amen on that one? If you are in relationship with God through Jesus Christ this morning, you are no longer condemned by God. You are now his friend, according to Scripture. So what was affected? Why was it affected? It was affected, right? And I love this. By the way, I'm going to be quoting a little bit from this book, The Six Miracles of Calvary by William R. Nicholson. Comes out of Discovery House, you know, Our Daily Bread, you know, in Grand Rapids. Good book. Really cheap. Worth the cost. But one of the things they said in there was the idea that it precisely happened at the moment Jesus, it was torn from top to bottom, and it was independent of the earthquake. It gave us access to the Holy of Holies because of the sacrifice and because Christ fulfilled the law. God accepted the sacrifice that made a way for us. Now, what's the application of this point? I didn't write it up here, but you can write it down. Here's the application. The curtain has been opened for us, causing celebration and knowing that it's open to all still. That's why we preach. It's still available until you breathe your last breath. That's why we share the gospel. But it didn't just affect the curtain. It affected creation. Right? So look at what's said next. Matthew 27:51. He's the only one. He is the only one that accounts for what happens here. He says, and behold, the veil of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom, and the earth shook and the rocks were split. Wow. It affected creation. The earth shook. There was a massive earthquake and rocks were split. I don't know what it takes on the Richter scale to split rocks. You know? But it was incredible. So the creation responds, okay? But watch this. What was affected? The rocks, it says, were affected. The rocks were split. Specifically, only the graves of the saints and nothing else. I mean, think about when you see earthquakes on TV. They're very indiscriminate. They wipe out about anything that's around them, right? But God's miracle is so precise that it only splits the rocks. How in the world is that possible? Unless it's supernatural. Unless it was God's symbolism. Okay? And I want to show us this. This is so interesting. So the rock split. Again, it coincides with Christ's death and his final cry. It's at the very moment of the cry, and we're going to see in a minute that it's going to cause the tombs to open. This earthquake, this particular one, is going to split the rocks, and it's going to open up some tombs. This is just, I mean, this is a story that only God can tell, right? Now watch this. So why is this significant? Here's what I believe is going on at this time. The creation was responding to this because of its future redemption. Creation had been affected, and his victory had affected creation as well. His dying on the cross. Now watch this. Look at your cross references. Genesis 3:17-18. Then to Adam he said, this is God giving out the consequences after the fall of man, after sin. Because you've listened to the voice of your wife and you've eaten from the tree which I had commanded you, saying, you shall not eat from it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In toil you will eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles it shall grow from you, and you will eat the plants of the field. Now why is that important? It's important because sin didn't just affect man. Sin affected God's creation. And look at Romans 8. I love these beautiful verses. verses in Romans 8, 19 through 22. For the anxious longing, the creation eagerly awaits for the revealing of the sons of God. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it in hope, that the creation also might be set free from the bondage, from the slavery to corruption, to the freedom of the glory of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groans and suffers in childbirth together until now. Look at this. Verse 20. Who subjected the creation to futility? I always used to think that was Adam because of his sin, but if you look carefully, it's God. God was the one that cursed the ground. God was the one that subjected creation to this futility, and because of it, it groans. Metaphorical, it's groaning. It's like the earth is saying, look at what you've done to us. It's now groaning. Look at the creation today, as beautiful as it is. We know it's been affected. We look at earthquakes, we look at tornadoes, we look at all the stuff that goes on. We look at just the way, you know, if it weren't for sin, the Greenpeacers wouldn't have a job. Right? Because they're all about saving the creation. There's nothing wrong with being a good steward of God's creation as believers. But we got other things to focus on. Our focus is on winning people to Christ. Right? But it affected that. And it groans. It's waiting for the sons of God to be revealed. It's waiting for the day, finally. So I think this is kind of a foreshadowing that somehow the creation knows its time is coming. It's just amazing. You say, well, that's reading into Scripture. The heavens declare the glory of God. Right? All the places in the Scripture that talk about creation praising God and responding to God. Why would this seem weird? That the creation would respond to the victory of its creator over death and sin on the cross, knowing that it's going to be freed from bondage one day. It's like the creation. Hey, here's the reality. Creation is smarter than we are. Creation knows how to praise God automatically. We have to be like dragged to worship God. Really? Come on, Christians. I'll say this to you, and I'll say it to anybody else I know. What, are we going to let creation beat us to praise? No. We've got more to offer God in praise because he redeemed us than creation does, and yet creation knows how to cry out. We know. What's wrong with us? Creation's crying out because of all of this. Now watch this. This is interesting. In Exodus 19, 16 through 18, it says, so it came about on the third day. This is in the giving of the law. When it was morning, there was thunder and lightning flashes and a thick cloud upon the mountain, a very loud trumpet sound. So all the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. This is in the giving of the law. Now Mount Sinai was in all smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire, and the smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked violently. It was almost as if when Christ cried out, having kept the perfect law, that God knew that the people would break. It was almost like you can connect the old covenant and the new covenant, and you can connect what happened on Mount Sinai with what happened on Mount Calvary. It was the response to God's judgment that it had been accepted. So watch this. What's the application for us? It's simply this. Even creation is affected by sin, and not only that, but it is affected by redemption. Everything ties together. Everything works together in God's plan. Right? Now let's look at the next thing that happens. The effect on the crypt. Okay? So it says in Matthew 27, the tombs were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of the tombs after his resurrection, they entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now this is really, really, really interesting. What was affected? Only the tombs of the saints, not unbelievers, were opened by the earthquake. There were probably a lot of dead people in Jerusalem. I'm guessing, right? By the way, the tombs that it's talking about, has anybody ever had the privilege of getting to go to Jerusalem? Okay. A few have. They don't bury, for the most bury their dead the way we do. Okay, we bury them in a hole. They bury them in these caves. Okay, so that's what a tomb was for them. And so when this earthquake hit, right, it affected the tombs. It opened the tombs. And you say, well, what is the big deal? Well, if you look at Jesus' tomb, and you look at the stone they would have rolled over that tomb, Fritz, you and I, and Pat couldn't move that, the three of us. Those puppies were heavy, right? And yet, they were open. They were knocked wide open. But what's interesting here is, if you notice the scripture carefully, if you don't read it carefully, I used to think those saints were raised from the dead right then and there. They weren't. Look at it. Look at the text carefully. It says, and they came out of the tomb after his resurrection. They couldn't precede his resurrection. And what happens here, and I think symbolically what goes on here, is that we have this idea of now we have access to life. It was like the tomb is open, and it's saying there's nothing that can stop death anymore. Right? There's now an access to life. We've already seen the access to God with Jesus in the curtain. Now we're seeing Jesus' death is going to make a way for life to happen, for us to be able to access life. Right? Now watch this. Why was it effective? It's a climax of previous miracles. So if you look at the first two miracles, and it anticipates the miracles to come, and they foreshadow the resurrection, okay? And these resurrections that are happening with the saints, by the way, who are the saints? Who are the saints? New Testament has been written. Who is it? It's got to be Old Testament saints, right? Can't be the New Testament because New Testament hasn't happened yet. These are Old Testament saints. Uncle Judah. Uncle Judah got raised up. You know? Uncle Daniel. I'm picking Jewish names, right? So these are Old Testament saints who were forced, probably looking forward to the promised Messiah. And God raised them up. And he specifically, these are Old Testament believers who are looking for the coming of Christ. So what happened with Lazarus, Jairus' daughter, the widow of Nain? They're a picture of the future resurrection of both Old and New Testament saints. Now watch this. The fact that the saints don't come out of the grave until after, this is what this author would contend, and I agree with him completely. The open graves were meant to be an exhibition. They opened the door from death to life, and the connection between the earthquake and the splitting of the rocks and opening the tombs is symbolic of victory over death and entrance into life. Again, they were open, but they weren't raised until afterwards. So they were still dead until after Christ's resurrection. What I think is really cool here is he says, last in a series of physical miracles with symbolic meanings, representing a separation of judgment, darkness, and the stone in the tomb, and they are in purposeful order. These miracles must come in a particular order. So you have to have the curtain first, then you have the splitting of the rocks, and then you have, right, the opening of the tomb. So they come in successive order on purpose, right? And what does that show? First of all, sin's dealt with, right? We saw the darkness come over last week. We saw sin's been dealt with. Now the access, the curtain is torn. Access is available to God. Now the access to resurrection life is possible only after these things are dealt with. Wow. 1 Corinthians 15. This is the one of the scriptures I gave for cross-reference. It says, but when the perishable will have put on the imperishable, and this mortal will put on immortality, then will come about the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your victory? O death, where is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. I believe that this was symbolically showing the truth of 1 Corinthians 15, that death has been defeated. Not completely yet, because everything isn't put in place yet. But this is a picture of the fact that Jesus defeated death and has now opened up a way to to life for us. Right? And watch this. This is interesting. Hebrews 2, 14 to 15. The writer says, therefore, since the children of share in flesh and blood, he himself, Christ, likewise also partook of the same, that through his death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might free those who are through the fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. Jesus, because of what he's done, and because of God accepting the sacrifice, he tasted death for us, but he's going to show us that death isn't the end. Let me say that. Death isn't the end. David, I don't mean to pick on you this morning, but I'm here to proclaim to you this morning, brother, that through Christ Jesus' death, death is not the end. For my family, my sister and I were the only believers in a room of about 40. I can't make that same promise to them because they haven't trusted Christ for salvation. But what I can make is the promise that if you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you can know this, that death is not the end. As a matter of fact, I think as believers, we should welcome it. We should not be afraid of it. We should welcome it, knowing that one day through Christ, we will be with Jesus forever and ever and ever. So what's the application? Do we realize that death is not the end for the believer? I didn't give you this cross reference, but you can write it down. John 11, 28 through 30. Martha shows up. She greets Jesus as he's coming in to town. Lazarus has been dead for 4 days. And if you look at the text carefully, Jesus stayed away on purpose. That just seems like a cruel joke, doesn't it? Jesus has the power to heal your brother, and he stays away on purpose. What's wrong with you, God? But if you look at the text carefully, he stays away on purpose because his plan wasn't to heal him. His plan was to raise him from the dead, which was the greater of the miracles. And the problem is people wouldn't believe. She says, you know what? I know if you'd have been here, God would have given you. And he's trying to say, woman, you don't get what I'm about to do. And then he looks at her in these verses and says, listen, even if you die and you believe, you will not, you'll live. Do you believe this? And the question for us today is, if God were to take our breath out of our mouth today and we have truly trusted Christ alone for salvation, do we believe that we will live again, church?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to say it again. If we trust in Christ for salvation and God were to take our breath away today, do we believe that if we die, we will live again?
Yes.
Thank you. That's the right response. Yes. Now watch this. I'm going to go on to the fourth one. It didn't just affect creation, it affected people. In Matthew 27, you see the effect on the centurion. Okay? It says, now the centurion and those who were with him, keeping guard over Jesus, when they saw the earthquake and the things were happening. So this is their response to all the stuff that's gone on to the physical creation. Became very frightened and said, truly this was the Son of God. And then I love what Luke says in Luke 23, 47. He gives us a little bit different account. He says, now when the centurion saw what had happened, he began praising God, saying, certainly this man was innocent. And there's debate over whether or not what Matthew says, truly the Son of God, is really the right translation. Some people will argue he was basically saying, well, truly this man was a god. If nothing else, we know the centurion knew he was innocent, right? That they had just murdered an innocent man. And what I think is so interesting is like the centurion who had been witnessing all of this. So he had seen it with his eyes and watched this. Think about this possibility. And maybe even participated in the cruelty both physically and verbally toward Jesus. Can you imagine if he had been part of the beatings and he had been part of the verbal abuse? When he sees these things happen, he goes, truly this was the Son of God. He was innocent. mean, you want a sign? There you go. Right? And I love, I just love the cross references to this. What do we see in Matthew 27, 39 to 44? Again, that's the group that is hurling insults at him. And eventually one of the sorry, my head's kind of a fog this morning. One of the men who had been persecuting him on the cross turns and says, "Hey, you know, he's really the Son of God." Right? Then we see Pilate saying, "I find no guilt in this man." Luke 23, 14 to 15, you know, he's not deserving of death. Pilate knew that. The centurion recognizes him. Right? It's amazing what happens here with the centurion. Right? So the application. Let me ask us this question. Has what we've seen with Jesus cause us to declare him as the Son of God? Because if you cannot declare him the Son of God, it's very possible, according to 2 Corinthians 4:4, that the veil is still over your eyes. And you don't really believe who Jesus is. And you can't declare with a centurion that truly this was the Son of God. Let me go to the last point. It affects the crowds as well. We see their assertion of sorrow. It says, all the crowds who came together for the spectacle, that's about what it was, a spectacle, when they observed what had happened, began to turn, beating their breasts. This is amazing. Do you know the story in Luke 18? Where the story of a tax collector and a Pharisee, and they're praying in the temple, and the Pharisee looks at this wicked, sinful Gentile tax collector and says, "Well, thank God I'm not like him. Thank God I'm not self-righteous. Thank God I'm not like this." And it tells us in Luke 18, 13, "But the tax collector, standing some distance away, was even unwilling to lift his eyes to heaven, but was beating his breast, saying, 'God, be merciful to me, the sinner.'" Beating your breast was an act of contrition, an act of sorrow. And so these crowds who have probably been cheering all day for this to happen, when God did what he did, began to beat their breasts and said, "Oh my God, what have we done?" There was an act of contrition. It was a sign of mourning in strong emotion. It wasn't just, "Oh, that was bad." It was bad. It got to their souls. And then it's interesting in 2 Corinthians 7:10, in your cross references, it says, "For the sorrow that is according to the will of God produces a repentance without regret, leading to salvation, but the sorrow of the world produces death." God is going after people to be sorrowful. In Acts 2, 22 to 24, Peter was preaching to them. And he was saying to the very crowd that had crucified Jesus 50 days earlier, he said, "Look, I'm here to tell you that this man, Jesus, attested by God with miracles, signs, and wonders, which God performed through him in your midst, just as you saw, he was delivered over by God's predetermined plan." So don't get me wrong. It was God doing this. But he will hold responsible those who nailed him to the cross by the hands of godless men, the Romans. He was going after conviction. This crowd was sorrowful. And we don't know what kind of sorrow it was. It was either worldly or godly sorrow. It was either sorrow that truly led to repentance, to put their trust in Christ, the gospel writers don't tell us, or at least they were showing that injustice had been done. Now, when we think of Jesus' death, what is our emotional response? And what emotional response comes when we explain it to others? Are we grieved in our heart over Jesus' death? Do we realize who put him there? Do you know who put him there? Don't turn and point to your neighbor. Point to the one sitting in your seat. put him there. You and I nailed Jesus to the cross in a sense because of our sin. But in a sense, he was still willing to do it. We didn't make him go. He willingly went on our behalf, and it was our sin that nailed him to the cross. Amen. Amen. I hope and pray that the message today at least gets us thinking about what was effected after the cross. Now, in a minute, we're going to take communion. In a couple minutes, we're going to hear a song, we're going to sing. But I want you to listen to this song. It's not visual on the screen, it'll be auditory. It's a song by New Song called Wide Open. And it reminds me of the curtain that was torn. I want you to listen to the words carefully as we get ready to partake at the table in a minute. And I want you to think about what God did so that you and I can have access back to God and what it took for Jesus to do that. So reflect on these words as you listen to them.
Heaven's gates were closed. Jesus said to his disciples from John 14, verse 6, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Would you stand as we prepare our hearts for communion singing once again?
Through these series of messages, we'll truly, genuinely say, once again, every day, whether it's at communion table or whether it's in the busyness of my crazy day, I'll say, Lord, once again, remind me of your mercy. And Lord, break me inside. Give me the grief that I need properly out of response for what you've done for me. As the guys come forward just to help serve, the one thing I want to say this morning is, back to John 14, 6, what you just read. As we take these symbols today, these symbols, the symbol of the bread that was broken on our behalf, and the symbol of the cup that was shed for our blood, reflect today on the fact that these two symbols, because of Jesus' death and sacrifice, and God's accepting of those sacrifices on our behalf, that's what opened the curtain. That's what made the way. And I don't know about you, but that curtain, it was so cool. I didn't say this in the message. They believe that curtain was anywhere from 18 inches to 3 feet thick. Oxens, a team of oxen would have had a hard time tearing it apart. But God, with, I believe, his breath, split it down and said, thank you, Jesus, for being willing to leave my side, being willing to go and die on their behalf. And we can say, thank you, Jesus, as we celebrate these elements today. Thank you that these are reminders of the fact that you made a way when there was no way. Let's pray. Father, don't let us enter into this time lightly. Don't let us enter lightly. Even if you have to break our heart right now, break our heart. And may we just humbly remember that you didn't have to do this. You did it because of your love for us. And Lord, that you didn't blow off sin. Jesus paid the penalty for our sin. So we can't take that lightly. Yeah, we get to enter in and rejoicing and singing, but we can't enter in without going through the blood and through the body. And remember, every time we do this, that it's because of you that we have a right relationship with you. So, Father, help us to worship you as we take these elements down. Help us to reflect on the fact that you made a way for us, and it's only your way that allows us to have that right relationship. We worship you now in Jesus' name.
Thank you.
Jesus, man, away from him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for what you've done for us. Thank you for how creation even cried out. How there were those who at the cross were sorrowing. They knew that an innocent man had been put to death. And Lord, we know that he was innocent. And he shouldn't have been put to death in one sense. But because he was innocent, he was the only one that could pay for our sins. Father, thank you for that. And Lord, I thank you, Father, not just for the salvation that we have from your wrath and from your justice. But Father, the fact that we have salvation and we have not only eternal life forever, but we have abundant life now. Remind us, Father, this week, as we go through this week, that whatever need we have, you've met at the cross. We can trust you. We've trusted you for salvation. We can trust you with our very lives. So, Lord, meet us at our point of need this week. And, Father, may we remember not to let creation beat us to the praise. We want to cry out before the rocks do, because we've been redeemed. And Lord, we want to share the message of the good news of an open way back to you, Lord. The most loving thing we can do for the lost person is to tell them about salvation that's found in Christ alone. Stir our hearts, Lord, as an act of worship as we leave here, that we would share Jesus, the good news of the gospel, that there's a way back to you, God. There's a way to forego your wrath that you paid for us through your blood. Father, give us opportunities to rejoice and to share Jesus with people this day and in the week ahead. And help us to live our life in light of the cross as well. And we'll give you the honor and glory that you deserve, knowing that we will be edified through it. And we ask it all in Jesus' precious name.
You stand as we send you singing the old rugged cross.
On a hill far away stood an old rugged cross.
As you leave here today, I want you to reflect on two things this week. First of all, I pray that God doesn't get the cross off your mind all week. I pray that you keep coming back to the cross and thinking and thanking God for all he's done for you. And secondly, I want you to know that the cross changes the way we live. It should change the way we live in godliness, but also our perspective. And so, as you go your way this week, Father, I pray for your body, that we would go and you would constantly remind us of what you've done for us, that we'd never forget, no matter how long we've been saved or how long we live, we will never forget what you have done for us and what that means for us, Lord. That not only does it open a way up for a relationship with you, but it gives us eternal life, even past death. But it also gives us a new life to live for you. Father, give us your perspective this week. May we use it to honor and glorify you in all we say and do. In Jesus' precious name.